Thanks, Chairman, for your presentation. I'm going to introduce you to the new BB Bang panchromatic emulsion from Color Holographics. It was mentioned before that Color Holographics only produced monochromatic emulsions. We actually produce green, red, and blue emulsions, but we now have also a panchromatic emulsion, so that list must be updated. This is like the end of a very long process. This panchromatic emulsion was started like 2-3 years ago, and they got some good results, but for some reason just the process just slowed down. Now we are ready, I think, to introduce the emulsions in the market, and I'm going to be talking about in this short. How's this one? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'll start first with a background. Can I make this thing work? How? Well, yeah. I will mention some emulsion characteristics, which is we're working with the same emulsion as with the other plates, so it's going to be common as with the other emulsions we produce. Then we will mention some results and applications, and I will end with the conclusions. Why is the need of for color holography? Well, you can see it in the display there. There's one red hologram and there's one color hologram. This is an equivalence with photography. At the beginning, photography was black and white, and people were pleased, couldn't take daguerreotypes, and then black and white photographs. It was a good way of having a memory of something. But when color emulsions for photography became available, people were more pleased, and not all people, but most of the people were started using color, multicolor emulsions. The same, I think, is going to happen with holography. The red holograms, or green holograms, or blue holograms, a single color, they compare very well with black and white photography. It's just like a black and red three-dimensional image. It's got the advantage of three-dimensionality, but hasn't got the color. So what Astiola did, and we are doing, or trying to do, the next step is just to go into multicolor images, which reproduce the object as it is, really. Not only the three-dimensionality, but also the colors that the image needs to have. There are several ways of making full-color holograms. One of them is using multiple slit transmission holograms, stereograms, an example is what Color Holographics makes with movie posters. And some other companies also do these stereograms. Pseudocolor is a very complex technique with a single laser, just to build up three colors in three different spaces and end up with a pseudocolor hologram. It's not real color. It can be very close to real color, but it's not real color. And the third method is just using multiple laser recording. For multiple slit and pseudocolor, we can work with monochromatic emulsions, and we can use a single laser, and we can get that color effect. But for the third one, for multicolor, multiple laser recording, we need to have at least three different wavelengths, and we need to have a panchromatic emulsion. We can't work with a monochromatic emulsion to do proper color holograms. In our case, we're working with our standard emulsion for making these panchromatic emulsions. Since the response of this emulsion has been very good for all the three wavelengths for the plates we produce. All blue, green, and red plates have been giving very good results, and people are not complaining about them, not much at least. The mean grain size is between 15 and 20 nanometers at the moment. The thickness of the layer, we have an average of 6 microns. We only coat glass plates, we don't do films. At the moment, we are just trying to address that direction, but we're still doing some preliminary testings. And the absorbing curve for this panchromatic emulsion is much lower than what Fuji showed. As you see, Fuji in the absorbance curve, they were all, for all the wavelengths above 0.5, we are below that point for all the wavelengths. But it's quite flat, not flat completely, but quite flat response. We did some testing for this emulsion. We not only produced the emulsion, we also tried to first characterize, well, try to find out which was the right composition for this emulsion. And so we did some testing. For this testing, we used three lasers, helium cadmium, helium neon, and one 532 laser, and a 10-Hsu setup, which is shown in these photographs. Again, the first one is a... No, it doesn't lock me now. Okay, the upper one is the red, illuminated by the red laser. You see the yellow because it's saturated, the image is saturated. The lower image is just the setup illuminated by white light. And that is one of the objects we used, which is polychromatic, no saturated colors, some smarties and two small figurines. There is a mirror on the back. You see the reflection on the of the table on that mirror. And it's Denisuk at 30 degrees. The processing we use as a standard one is first we presensitize the plates since it needs to increase the sensitivity a little bit for 2 minutes in a TEA solution of 3%. And then after that, since there's some solution on the surface of the plate, we just washed it with a bit of deionized water, expose the plate, and then develop for 1 minute at 30 degrees with pyrogallol. After that, we wash the plate and bleach with the EDTA bleach, wash again, and dry. The sensitivity we achieve with this material is quite high. As it was mentioned before, you can't start with the blue exposure. We made lots of testings with three exposure holograms, starting with the blue, and the other ones all came dim, with right colors but dim. What we think is that the blue light at the beginning, as the first exposure, kills the plate. Yes. Gets all or almost all the grains, and then just a few are remain for the blue, sorry, for the green and the red exposure. So now we're starting with the green. The sensitivity is not bad. It's 80 millijoules per square centimeter. For the red, that's second exposure, is 100 millijoules, sorry, microjoules per square centimeter, and then the blue is 90 microjoules again. That is in accordance with the absorbance spectrum I showed to you, the response spectrum, which is quite well balanced for all these three wavelengths. I'm going to show you some results now, but take in consideration that they are only photographs, so they won't show the real image. I got the holograms with me, so if someone's interested in having a look at them after the session, when the session's finishes, I will be very happy to show them to you. That's actually an all-hologram made with old emulsion. It shows all three colors. It shows blue, it shows yellow, red, green. That's another example. That's a recent one. The blue is going in the photograph. The blue is in the hologram, really. Trust me. That one, yes, that's a greenish one. That's overloaded with green, that plate. But it's a very sharp image, what we have in there. It's very low noise. And that one is slightly going to the pink, sorry, to the with a lack of green, a bit reddish. But it's very good colors in the jewelry, in the small jewelry thing you can see there. That's the hologram of the object I saw in the setup slide. It's got all the colors, it's got the blue, it's got red, it's got different blues, even greens on the background. So I got more holograms in there with me, so if you want to see them, I will show them to you later on. The applications for color holography are, well, loads of applications we can think of, much more than the ones I'm going to mention. One of them is museum, showing museum artifacts, very expensive ones, without a waste of space if the machine hasn't got the space for showing the artifact. Jewelry displays in sub windows, sub windows, to avoid having the jewelry in the window itself. Display of any expensive artifact. For security, also making three exposures is more complicated to force than using a single exposure or single laser for recording. Holographic optical elements, multicolor ones, and full color reflection holograms, and many other applications that are probably you probably will think in the future when these emulsions are available. So, concluding, we have a very nice emulsion with superior quality and can be used for holographic applications. The sensitivity is not bad. We're very happy with it. It's below 100 microjoules per square centimeter. We have a good color reproduction, brightness, and clarity, and very low scatter in the images. And the plates are very easy to use. Don't need any special treatment apart from this presensitizing thing. The rest is just common work. And that's it. Thank you.
Why are you calling your emulsion panchromatic? In same way as Fuji emulsion, your emulsion is dichromatic, because you have very big scattering, so in matter of fact, you cannot record good blue holograms. You can record only red and green holograms. So your emulsion, in matter of fact, is dichromatic, bichromatic, not panchromatic.
No.
I can see some blue color, but with 20 nanometers, in the matter of fact, you cannot get good blue. The same comment would be for future emulsion. It's also bichromatic emulsion, not panchromatic.
Then that means we are wrong. It's not between 15 and 20. It's probably between 10 and 15 then. There's one thing we haven't done. We haven't measured the grain size. But that is silver highlight material. It's not a dichromate.
I know that it's not the dichromate.
And you can record very good blue holograms with it if you use them for single recording.
Okay, so then your material probably is panchromatic, but okay.
Well, if it is, we call it panchromatic. We think it's panchromatic.
Yes. What we need is really a more scientific way. You need to record a Macbeth test target, take a spectrophotometer, measure it on the target, and measure it on each color patches. Tomorrow we will discuss on Thursday more about this technique. Then we know exactly how accurate we can reproduce colors. So this is something that needs to be done in this field, because when you go out to companies like Coca-Cola and you want to make the Coca-Cola red, they will ask how far in chromaticity coordinates are you off in your hologram. So these are very important things. Anyhow.
Also, in your exposure
No, I'm working. We are working. We are testing the plates with three simultaneous exposure. Three, one after another. That's why I've mentioned the order: green, red, and then blue.
Once you hyper.
Through the interface, some will bounce back again and be absorbed on the way. So in fact, you have to be very careful in the combination of color and reflectance to get the right result. It's not easy. And I think many people don't understand Fresnel's laws. They're actually quite tough. They say that if light is going to reflect off an object, it must go in the surface, have a rattle around and have a peek at what's going on, and then come out again. And so the combination of the real and the imaginary parts of the reflectance is what you're actually looking for.
If you can answer that, we're just putting in the market this emulsion, and but we know that all the holographers that are here in this room and many others that are not here today will make them better. We'll get better development developers, we'll get better processing techniques, we'll get better recording ways. So that's why I did with a very small lab, and we did with a very small laboratory. We just tried to get the right colors by not sifting, not making any, creating any shrinkage or any distortion in the plate. So we think the accuracy of the reproduction is quite good, and we haven't measured it, but we know that you would make them much better than they are, and we have done. Sorry.
Once you hypersensitize the plate, how long does it last before the sensitivity starts degrading again?
For these ones, for these experimental coatings we did, because now plates are ready for production, but we did some experimental coatings for balancing everything, it was 1 month. It's not long, it's a short time, but it's 1 month. In 1 month, you need to presensitize. But if you presensitize in a careful way, if you leave the plate to dry properly, you washed the excess of DEA that you have in the plate essentially goes back to the same thickness, so you don't have any shrinkage after processing.
So you can hypersensitize again after a month?
Oh, yeah, the plates don't die. The plates just lose the sensitivity by some process we still don't know completely. We know a little bit more now, but then after that, the plates are good for years. You just need to put them in water or water with 3 DA solution, and they work. They work as good as new.
Do they work the same when you put them in water, the same when you put the DA solution?
If you put them in water, in deionized water with some wetting agent, it's not so sensitive. DA adds some sensitivity, of course. But it's only like 1.5 times, 50% higher sensitivity, not much. So you can use water for presensitizing, for recovering the plate, really.
There appears to me that I feel like there's an 800-pound gorilla in the room that nobody is talking about. Isn't it extremely important to look at the nature of the light that's used for the reconstruction? None of you guys are talking about the reconstructive light, and it's such. And Hans knows particularly, if you ain't got the right light, you know what I'm saying. Why aren't none of you guys talking about it? You know, I find it a very curious phenomenon.
Sorry, we're only producing plates. We're not doing lighting systems. I'm sorry. But probably. There's probably better ways of doing it. But if you use, someone was mentioning yesterday in one conversation about using LEDs for this. It's going to be very complicated because you need the right LEDs for that. It needs to be tuned with the peak of the wavelength you are, because there are only 3 wavelengths in there. And if you use 4, it's more complicated. You need exactly the right wavelength. This is an halogen light. Everybody's using that for replaying holograms. So that's what all I can say.
In actual fact, that's the point when I just comment there. The high temperature of the lab which is used to construct the hologram is very crispy indeed. Thank you. And if the light is too hot, there's too much blue coming out of the lamp, and that produces the effect of Rayleigh scattering. And if there isn't enough of the blue, then of course we know what happens. If you want to optimize the efficiency of the lamp for lighting a hologram, you need to think it through. And a little calculation shows that you only need a color temperature of something like 2,000 degrees to hit the jackpot. So anybody doing serious work for exhibitions should understand the role of the scattering effect. And we get back to these nasty little grains again, and the calculations of Lord Rayleigh.
Yes, I can mention that, for example, many people have started to use for monochrome holograms LED lights like orange, red, in particular Ron Olson in San Francisco who moved there. He used that, and that works extremely well. And on Thursday, I will talk more about this light issue when I talk about the state of the art of color holography. So we will discuss that on Thursday.